Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to give a brief talk on the usefulness of technical data for the application of the incentive, really. The reason this came about is I did some work with a UK onshore operator last year looking at some data sets, and there were some quite interesting, quite key results that came out of that, which I'll show you today. So in terms of the content of this talk, I'll look at why use potential field data. Look at the UK and just with a couple of slides look at Poland as the reason why there's only a couple of slides which will be apparent in a minute. Look at the public domain data, which is actually quite a useful starting point. The next step after public domain data, look at the model example, and then the majority of this talk is going to be concentrated on gravity data. But there's also a place for magnetic data in this kind of exploration. So I guess historically, gravity seems a regional tool. And I guess within all companies, the experience is generally limited. It tends to be the kind of consultants, potential field experts, working outside, who tend to look at this data. With potential field data, you always have the issue of non-uniqueness, whereby arguably, two different geological settings can give a similar gravity response, which is always going to be an issue. Hopefully, with correct integration, working both with other data sets to give constraints and also with a reasonable size of common sense, you can get rid of a lot of that non-unique, most reasonable results. So, what use potential field data? Well, in terms of current data, there's public domain data that's available, which I'll look at in a minute. And really what you want to be doing is trying to integrate it with the seismic data and the world data to come up with a constrained model. And all of this is really to improve your understanding. In terms of looking ahead and your further acquisition, you've got a couple of options in terms of onshore. You've got airborne, whereby you can cover large areas very quickly. And also land, which can give you very high resolution data set, but obviously a much generally at a much smaller scale. In terms of exploration, for instance, in the UK, it's a passive, relatively small-scale presence in terms of footprint, and maybe probably most importantly, it's cheap compared to 3D seismic surveys, etc. So just a few headline slides, really, and probably more better presented information as we do a Google search. You can consider UK onshore as being actually the early exploration, I guess. It's been a small number of wells when you consider, as Dave just mentioned, comparison to the Barnett Shale in the US, the size equivalent of the West Midlands. There's a reasonable amount of 2D seismic shot of various vintages, various quality, limited 3D seismic, and certainly there's plans for a small number of wells onshore UK. And there's also this controversy and the risk without further exploration and drilling. So the question for this talk really is, how can potential field data or what potential field data offer? Now we'll look at the BGS land gravity data set, and this is a database put together by the BGS, which includes both BGS and other external data sets that have been integrated into it. Now it actually comprises 165,000 land gravity stations over the whole of the UK. With an average kind of point space of approximately 1.6 kilometres squared. And the good thing about this data set, it's free to download. So you can go onto the BGS website, download it, take a look at it. An example of that data on the right there is the coverage map. So that's the point sampling that is available. And on the right there is the product you download to start with, which at that scale, looking at kind of northern England, is relatively, doesn't particularly meaningful, you just get a very regional picture. But with various techniques you can apply to potential field data, filtering and such forth, you can start pulling out a lot more information than what you see on that image on the right. On the right there, there's an image of an isopat map of the Boland Hollow formation, that again is just taken from the web. What I hope to see is by plain slides through, is that when you get that data and start applying various filters and various techniques to it to extract more detail, and that's about as far as you can push the BGS data. There's a good correlation between what you've seen on the that ice pack map, for instance, and what you see on that graph. That arguably there's a better level of detail in there than what's mapped on there. And also you've got, I think this map's actually been updated now with those mapping programs, but it's certainly not complete. And what I looked at with the project last year is how to combine these two data sets together and hopefully update and improve. What we've done here is put together a coverage heat map. So that map there shows the increase in coverage across the UK. So the dark colours being where you've got relatively decent coverage, decent resolution, and then the lightest colours being where it's less good. And that plays a role, particularly when you're coming to look at more or additional acquisition, where to infill, whether you need to infill, what actually you allowed by acquiring different data. I'm going to quickly turn to Poland. There is an equivalent data set in Poland that was completed in the 80s. It's believed to have approximately 800,000 draft stages. It's a very high-risk data set. Now, up till a couple of years ago, that entire data set could be purchased for $100 or $200. And then from the 1st of January 2012, that rose horrendously to over $4 million. Now, as far as I'm aware, there's been purchased, so unsurprisingly, it's been made with that data set since. Now, I've used that data set in the past, and it's a very good data set. If you look in Poland and you have access to that data set, through what it means, I would recommend strongly you look at that data set. It's the equivalent of what I've just shown with the BGS data. I can't recommend spending $4 million on that. I have an image, that's it. So it doesn't really do justice there, but you start filtering, you start applying techniques to that data set, you get a lot of information starts being extracted out. So what can be achieved with this data set? I've got an example here of where we've taken the graphic data, compared it with the seismic data where it was available, and come up with a structure map mapping out faults and minimums, basal areas, brilliant bodies, particularly in North England. And then comparing that to the kind of known map structures. And hopefully that's a useful bit of information at that scale. Secondly, unfortunately I don't have this bit, so I can't show this is a generic example. You can do 2D modelling, so you can map or model on top of your seismic data, combine it with the gravity magnetics and come up with a constrained set of geological 2D models that satisfy both or multiple data sets. And then thirdly, again, this is actually a generic example from some work I did in the offshore central Brabant. What we're able to do is produce a basement surface or some kind of depth to be able to target the structure surface from that data, which again can be integrated to in your seismic world data level that you have. So the question I guess would be, what next? The BGS data we're only getting so far because of the resolution it has. So if you come down in scale and high resolution is needed, and you want to do more acquisition, then I guess the question is, which method to use? Do you go, you should an airborne survey or do you do a land survey? So the pros of an airborne survey, certainly survey large areas very quickly. Certainly used in other areas for sighting 2D or 3D seismic surveys, which is no ground presence, so that is an issue. And to date, as far as I'm aware, there's been two FDG or gravity gauge geometry surveys that have been acquired onshore UK, which is a kind of a higher resolution gravity data set, which can be useful if you're looking at shallower targets, shallower faulting, etc. Now, the downside of airborne, there's certainly noise associated with airborne platform, and so you want to look at realistically what uplift you would get from acquiring airborne data given you already have the BGS data as a starting point. It's not such an issue in the UK, but it's quite important to consider. And based on the kind of size of blocks in the UK, it's probably going to be more suited to a sort of multi-client approach. really practical and expensive to survey single blocks as an airborne technique. If we jump to land acquisition, where it's still the highest resolution data available, static reading, it's certainly low cost and relatively unobtrusive. Go back and survey an area. Because of the extra high resolution, you can go down to sort of block or site specific scale. Arguably, it is useful for well planned directional drilling that depends on the resolution. And it's certainly easy to fill in that PGS data where you already have it. The downside of land acquisition, well, is just the fact that large scale areas is just impractical to cover realistically due to the length of acquisition time it will take. Regardless of which technique you may consider, there's kind of I certainly recommend some kind of feasibility study to establish which is suitable. And the three things to consider really is going to be the depth of the target, the size of the structure, and particularly the graphic density contrast. And certainly in the UK, it's probably more suited to the southern areas generally, in the generally, like the shallower structures you're interested in, and effectively the shallower structure, the better, the higher resolution data you can get back. So what we're going to look at now is this is taken from the web, but this is a 10-kilometer section taken from the Weald Basin. Now, the reason we've chosen this is it's got quite a high level of complexity and faulting, and faults propagating from deep to shallow, so it should give a good response for what we're trying to achieve. So what we'll do is take that section, turn it into a 3D model and look at the different acquisition techniques and what will work and what may not. So here we have that section, and the values there represent the densities of the rocks involved. And the two curves above, the red curve represents just the recorded gravity response over that sequence. And it's certainly picking out the main highs and lows and structures within that data set. The blue trace above that is just a filter or a first filter group of that data set, which starts to pull out a bit more detail. So hopefully from that you can see it starts to pick up a bit more information about the shallow parts and the shallow structure, etc. What we've done in this instance is taken that single line and then replicated it as a 10-kilometer block 3D model. The three different profiles through there are all varying as you move from line to line, but trying to stick with reasonably geological faults, geological throws, information that we got from that single line. So fingers crossed, it should give a reasonable representation of the geology. And also the cross-cutting faults and other information that they're trying to get it. Okay, so the slides I'll show here, just to simplify, going from top to bottom is the sort of equivalent of the BGS data, although it's an optimistic view of the BGS data, to be honest. The middle one is the equivalent of an airborne survey, and the bottom one is the equivalent of a land gravity survey. Probably the key slide to look at is that far column, going from top to bottom. The BGS data gives you a reasonable here of main highs and lows, doesn't give you much information other than that really. Move on to the airborne data. Now whilst that's a good high quality data, we suffer from the fact of flying 150-200 metres above the surface. So that's what really need to see. So you certainly get an uplift between the BGS data. And then the question would be, is over an area, how good is that BGS data to start with? And is the uplift worth the cost of flying airborne survey? And then the bottom image is a land data, where there's a much more improved image of that subsurface with a breaking over the faults and the cross-cutting features within that top image. So it's very much the scale of the structures and features you're interested in. Just as a very cartoony example, but this is kind of how you can see it working. If you had an area where you had a couple of vintage seismic lines, maybe a well, and that was about it. If that was effectively your underlying geology, which obviously you had limited information on, and you went out and shot a land clarity survey, for instance, that's the kind of map you will get back, picking up the detailed information about that subsurface. The question is that useful information going forward? And on the slide on this, where we mapped where those kind of faults and offsets and trends are and how that relates to that, that 3D model. More on the kind of the logistics of such surveys. Well, if you're looking at a 2x2 kilometre block and you're, say, working at a 50 metre sampling range, it's got high resolution data, 1600 gravity stations, 100 stations a day, you're looking at around about 20 days at position time to do a high resolution survey over such an area of 2x2. Just step out to a 10x10 block, you're up the sampling, more stations, but equally you're still looking about a month's acquisition to acquire a data set of that nature. If we jump to airborne, I'd say more, really more cities for larger areas, multi-client type approach. You're looking at an average of around about 1,000 kilometers a day. So if you take a look at 27 days a month worth of work, looking about 27,000 kilometers, which is equivalent to shooting at 75x50 block, 150x1 kilometre line space, then that was certainly the parameters that were used on the onshore UK surveys that was done in 2008. I want to jump quickly to magnetic data. Everything prior to this has been about gravity, and it's been a useful tool, but magnetic data is generally considered useful for volcanics, intrusives, that kind of system. However, mineralisation of faults can result in it being useful in more sedimentary settings. There's a good image here taken from SRK Consulting, where they've taken a narrow magnetic data set and then broken it down into its individual parts, so the intrusions of the gravels, the extrusives of alteration, and then the bending of the structure. So it can be useful. As an example, BGS is also a BGS aeromagnetic data set available. It's relatively detailed, although it's relatively old, so it's slightly limited in resolution. But again, as with the BGS gravity data, it's free and it's certainly worth the look. What I've got here, this is an African data set that we use made to hand. But what I'm trying to show here is the difference, again, the scales between airborne data set and land. That top image is an airborne data set which the magnetics is quite clearly showing a lot of information of the trends through an area. If we drop down to that block, which is about possibly 2x2 kilometre area, and you can see how that resolution of that scale starts to break up, you start to lose resolution. What I'm going to feed in now is we went back to this area, revisited the land magnetic survey, and that's kind of equivalent of the uplift you can get from doing the airborne to land. So certainly the airborne gives you a good starting point, but if you want to start getting down the scale, then it's that extra level of detail resolution that you need. Okay, so to conclude, certainly if you look in the UK, I would say take a look at that BGS dataset. It's a good starting point, particularly if you're trying to get a handle on the regional, how things fit together regionally. Again, Poland, the data does exist, but obviously at cost. If you look at further acquisition, well, the first starting point would be conduct some kind of feasibility study which says, A, when are you going to get any great uplift, and B, which technique should you use? I guess the key point I'm trying to get across here is that it's not just regional. If you acquire the right data set, you can get down to quite a tight level of information. And then finally, the last one is, yeah, it's not just gravity, there's magnetics, and there's other potential or other techniques that equally could be applied to these kind of settings.
Neil seeing is this return to a world that, I think I said earlier, that a lot of people would have said gone. You know, because explorers, I was the external examiner at Leeds for the geophysics course for half a dozen years. And one thing that was clear then was that nobody did field work anymore. Everybody looked at the world through a screen and all the projects were on screen. And yet, you're seeing in this world of unconventional the need to understand the rocks, get out in the field, do gravity and magnetics in the field, understand sedimentology, understand geochemistry. It's quite a different world from the one that a lot of our colleagues are used to. Okay, please.
I just want to know what sort of processing technique do you apply to the data set when you're trying to resolve it to match it up with the map? What sort of processing techniques do you apply?
Well, certainly for land graphs, the presentation is pretty straightforward. It's a set of standard process that takes you to the a mappable data set, and then from there. Once you've got the initial data set, there's various filters and derivatives and gradients that you can apply to the data to tease out the entropy of data. When you look at a standard map, it contains information from deep to shallow. So you kind of get overwhelmed by information. Once you start filtering from high temperatures, you start to pull out more high frequency for shallower information. And that's how you separate out. You leave from the shallow, the small scale features from the large scale features, etc.
Okay. Anybody else?
All right. Thank you, John. Thanks very much.